Waller, which is referred to as Irving for sure, and the three galleries we've been talking about, it changed the process of installation. Everything used to be on kind of ragweed walls and things jammed, chucked to jowl and what have you.
Salon style.
Yeah, salon style. And suddenly, overnight, through the Ferris and so on, you got to really look at the pictures. The walls were painted white. There was a space between them. And it made a real difference, I think, in terms of, I remember at that presentation of Andy.
Yeah.
Soup can just lined up one, two, three, four, five.
Well, a shelf around the gallery.
Everything was
a shelf around the gallery.
He didn't come out for that show.
He didn't come out for that show.
So who, how did you decide together to do the shelves?
Well, I wanted to ring the gallery. In other words, I wanted to have them exactly the same height, completely around the gallery. And then I thought of soup, and then I thought of shelf, and I called him and I said, I'm thinking about putting a little shelf, a little ledge, completely around the gallery, and showing him that way. He said, great, he didn't care.
Yeah.
But you came up with the idea.
But I came up with the idea of mostly keeping them all exactly even. Mm.
And Andy was always, yeah.
The painting kind of sat on the shelf, and I had a little bracket in the back that attached them to the wall. But they stood up on the shelf.
Well, that's one of the more brilliant things about it, is that they didn't rest, so they were both completely vertical, like paintings.
They were completely vertical.
But they were on shelves.
But they were
like
on shelves.
Yeah,
small. So like soup can, a small shelf. Small.
Irving was famous for one other thing. It's the first time we had seen it. You walk into the gallery, and it didn't, the name of the artist wasn't there, the price wasn't there, it was very non-commercial. Kaufman was there, we didn't know anything.
Yeah.
And it was terrific because it was like you were on your own and you had to deal with it.
Right.
And he didn't make it easy for you to, it wasn't but a commercial, you knew it was something special happening.
You have to deal with the dealers.
Everett, how many people worked for you in the second gallery, the bigger, better, just you?
No, I had
one person.
I had Paul Tanner's ex helper, the one who opened the gallery. You know what I'm talking about.
Paul Tanner and Frank Pearls, you went those two?
Well, Frank Gallery was designed by Alan Lustig. Remember Alan Lustig?
I do remember.
I think of her name in a moment. But she worked for Paul Tanner for years. Very sharp. Went to New York, opened a gallery of her own.
That's one of the
Gloria Cortella.
Oh,
Gloria Cortella, I remember her.
Gloria?
Yeah.
Gloria is the one who used to swim naked in your pool, right?
She's still there.
She's
in the pool.
She couldn't do that in my gallery, though. No, didn't allow that.
No nudity in the gallery.
He's balanced, didn't she? She was floating. He's balanced.
That doesn't happen, right?
Well, that's the work. That's who I had working.
I remember Gloria.
She's very professional. Good.
Mm. That's terrific. Because that's one of the. I mean, it's unthinkable today, but that's one of the stories about the pre-Irving Ferris is that Keenholz had a little studio in the back of it.
Yeah.
And he was the only one manning the gallery.
Yeah.
And if you could call him bell.
He was so pleasant to deal with.
And a little bell would go off when people came in, but suppose he'd never
respond.
And so it was just basically an empty room, which one, people weren't worried about stealing, but two, of course, it was impossible to ever sell anything because there was nobody there.
There was nobody there.
We had to take care of each other.
A piece of chicken on my head.
I remember walking in to see Frank Burroughs sitting behind his desk in Beverly Hills and wandering around. And he said, sit down. And I sat down. And he said, tell me what you're doing. And I told him.
This is after you were a dealer?
Yeah. I opened the gallery.
He knew who you were.
He knew he was late 50s. All of a sudden, he grabs my arm, and he's looking this way, and I kind of turn around. Very elegant lady, looking at a Chagall in his gallery, and he's just staring. She opens her purse, takes out the book of fabric swatches, and holds them up to the painting and turns the fabric swatches.
She's going to design someone's house?
And he gets up in a minute, up, grabs her ass. One hand on her ass, one hand on her leg. He walks through the front door. Comes back, talks to me, doesn't say a word again.
Now, what was Noel like? I mean, it must have been a pretty interesting experience to do something like Seagram's design the whole thing. Huh. Wall treatments, paintings, furniture, the whole.
Well, that was the missus. And that was Florence Helen. He was married to Hans. She had the planning unit, did all that. And I worked for her. And when she'd finish a room, she'd say, we need two paintings. And she'd throw me the fabrics. Mm-hmm. And then I always invariably bought Albers.
Because you funded any?
The perfect. It was at the Janus Gallery. You used to go to Janus.
The perfect Noel painter. That's
all.
Perfect.
Not to go to Frank Pearl's.
No. With fabric swatches. No.
So Albers was extremely important to all of you very early.
Early on. And each of us for different reasons.
Each of you for different reasons.
Yeah, I mean, if the room's predominantly green, you buy a green Albers.
Yeah. No fabric.
You can find any color you
need. Yeah.
No fabric can be outdone by an Albers. Right?
No. Just, no.
How about the Amzel Hathfield? Did you ever go in there?
Yeah.
At the hotel.
We were like, he was like from Mars.
Yeah.
Albert Dodge was important to me too. He became a really close friend. I wrote an article for Gopher Art Forum, as a matter of fact, on that painting at the LA County Museum and the other one. And I became a good friend a lot, and he wrote back, and we corresponded back and forth and back and forth. And I became the director in Fort Worth. I had not been able to buy much in Los Angeles, but my goal. When I went to Fort Worth, the first thing I wanted to do was to buy an Albers painting. And had just, in fact, bought from Richard Feigen a Clifford Still painting and a Joseph Cornell. And I was very proud of myself that I managed to convince the Fort Worth people of this. I wrote to Joseph. Joseph, I'm really now anxious to get a painting of yours because I have this painting. I bought this painting by Clifford Still. I bought this piece by Joseph Cornell, and I think the three of you represent the three different areas in terms of art and how it goes, the classic and the expressionist. And I didn't hear from him. And so I was in New York and I asked, say, Janice, I said, did one thing, I said, Joseph, and I said, the best of friends, I said, I hadn't heard, he said, you would never talk to you again the rest of your life.
Because I
mentioned Clifford Still first.
Clifford Still first.
I bought his painting before I bought Albert's painting. The end of that. So Annie remained a good friend the rest of my life.
Look at that. That was one.
Did he have a date? He met his first date?
Never.
That's all. That is mentioning Clifford Still's name in the presence of Barney. That was
strong feelings.
That was the
vision. He was very Germanic about it too. And Clifford Still was no pussycat. But it also was one of the first cases where, number one, the teacher hit on the pretty girl student, and that was his wife, Annie. And she was a terrific artist, and she gave up her career for him. And she was a terrific artist. She used fabrics and things.
These beautiful ones. Robert Gober.
But her career could have been much different. But she gave it up.
Robert Gober did a beautiful show in New York where he had.
I think it was expected. It was a
five
only
farmers' piece.
This is what happens, and that was
Matthew Marks.
Yes, yeah, too.
And it was Annie Albers. Textiles piece.
Oh, she was fabulous.
Katie Nolan.
Some things, but
it was things that you would never think would go together, and it sort of worked.
Henry.
Now,
which
museum
did you work for?
I think we got too much credit for the talent.
foundation.
She gave it up because I didn't think they were that talented.
She was really
talented. She was really talented. Annie Albers, and she was a student of the Bauhaus in Germany.
About 60 miles from
that's where they met. He was the teacher.
Anyway, and I did talk
Mayo
about...
Mayo teachers are notorious for hitting...
What are you about my name in the world of art?
I think that's the same.
No,
it's not. Since I Robert Motherwell, no, that's he was showing
the clothes that he
carried. Clothes.
Yeah, exactly. Did the right thing.
Which he gave out of their own collection. I remember I have a lot of money.
No, it's a very
beautiful show. Great. But 40s
and 30s. And it also was a time when fabric wasn't as hard.
They wanted to win on the art. Motherwell
yeah.
was a prejudice about the end.
Not,
much
not only was his dealer
of Thomas
Marlborough, but I was his next door neighbor because he and Helen found my brownstone duplex and it was next door to theirs.
Oh, that
people so I would leave out my bathroom in the morning and
so she suffered from that
talk
too.
To Helen.
Yeah.
That's what you did in Chicago.
So I was over there a lot and I worked with him.
You did Chicago.
Then I went on a tour through with this group to the museum. They had a very good show. I just sort of went away.
Yeah, you would think that would be
and I was,
that's okay, but it's only a world. The museums are run by males, the teachers were males, the gallerists were males.
You look around and see how it's changed, but not a lot.
Not a lot.
It's changed, but
there's still a way to go.
It was also the best concert I ever heard in my entire life.
Oh, that's thoroughly researched. Because it's everyone the highest level.
It's a beautiful place.
Yeah, it is a beautiful place, yeah.
And you know, it isn't that large, but it looks gigantic.
You know, Fort Worth is amazing when you think of the three museums that it has and the 55,000 people.
It has to go Art Deco, dude. What? Art Deco in Fort Worth, doesn't it, dear? No, maybe it doesn't. I'm not going to say Paul.
Have you seen the new Ando? The Ando?
I haven't.
You haven't seen it?
No, I haven't.
I haven't seen it either.
So here's the question. I saw it mostly done.
You saw it mostly done, and
I'm not. But it's well, one was such an incredible, Fort Worth was such a modest, the old Fort Worth was such a modest
right.
space, and then you see this Endo.
There's a guy called Bill Bell who lives here in town. Bill and Maria Bell, do you know them?
No.
In the television business, started by his father, make all kinds of money, and he now has hired Endo to do a house for him. In Melbourne.
Nice.
In where?
Melbourne.
Oh, great. Wonderful.
Who's he hired?
Tadeo Ando.
Oh, right.
It'll take 3 years.
Did you have him call Ando Tadeo?
Ando Tadeo. Tomorrow.
So what did our schedule, and now we disappeared?
We disappeared.
We rest up, and we meet back at 6:45.
6:45.
At the auditorium.
At the auditorium. At the auditorium.
Your mellifluous tones will
meet with us.
And dress more or less as we are. If that's
I'd say you're perfect.
Yes.
Really? Well, I'm not going. I'm not going home, so I'm going to. I'm going to dress this way.
I'm going to change.
Yeah.
And who's going to do the same? Who's going to wear? You're going to wear white tie and tails.
I'm going to wear what I'm wearing. Everett.
Yes.
I've got an appointment that came up, but why don't you? Can you come by the house before you come here? Is that possible for you, or did you ever go to